back, everyone, to Jersey Beach Volley Podcast. I'm your host, Rohan Chitella, and joining us today is Josue Castillo. On today's episode, Josue talks to us a little bit about how you can improve your athletic ability while stuck at home, the origins of the infamous face nutter, and lastly, what stoicism has to do with volleyball and how you can use it to improve. All right, everyone, welcome back to the podcast. Today, we've got another amazing and exciting guest, Josue Castillo. So, Josue, thank you so much for joining us today.
I appreciate you having me, man.
No problem. And just remind us and all the viewers, where are you joining us from today?
I live in Boston, but right now I'm in Jersey.
So you're back in Jersey.
Yeah, so when the quarantine kind of started and we got, kind of kicked out of work and we were working from home, we figured we'd come down with family. That way, we can support them in any way that they need.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that makes sense. Yeah. And you're from North Jersey, right?
Yeah, born and raised in North Jersey. Originally from Hudson County, North Bergen mm-hmm. area. And then we moved to Garfield when I was in like first grade or so. That's it.
Gotcha. So, with quarantine and corona and everything, everything been okay with you? Everything safe, everything good to go?
Yeah. Mom and dad are fighting a cold, I hope. They got tested a couple of days ago and we're waiting for mm-hmm. the results. But, they're doing well. And, that's kind of why I'm hesitant to go back up a little early before mm-hmm. I know, that they're okay. But, so far everything is great. So no complaints, man.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. I don't know for you, but for me, when I'm perusing through social media and stuff, I've been seeing some wacky conspiracy theories and wacky stuff. Man, have you seen anything that's stuck out to you so far?
Yeah, man, I watched this hour long documentary yesterday. It was through Facebook. Epoch Time, something like that. Okay. And it was just about this whole the Chinese Communist Party and just. Kind of putting the whole blame on them and how they're being sued from, pretty much entire countries for the backlash of, corona mm-hmm. and the economic effects and whatnot. But it was just, it dove into it in the research side and how they dove into, different things. But I don't know. Half the stuff you see is just all crazy. But
yeah,
it was just interesting to kind of listen to it.
No, exactly. I know what you mean. I think I saw this other theory. I don't know what platform I saw it on, but basically they were saying how the virus actually originated in a Siberian forest where they had an underground lab and they were testing it like subhuman reptilian species. And then they were transporting it to Wuhan and they got there was an outbreak or the vials got released or something. And that's how it infected everyone. That's just unbelievable, right?
Yeah, we're living through history. I was talking to a friend and it's going to be crazy once the actual truth comes out, because through this, mm-hmm. there's going to be a bunch of speculation, but eventually when the actual objective truth comes out, I think it's going to shock everyone. And, we're living through history. This is it.
It's crazy. But anyways, I digress. So I guess we can get back on track. I know I definitely have a lot of stuff I want to talk to you about.
Sure.
And similar to my previous talk with Fraser, I think the first thing I definitely want to dive into is your early life. So if you could just kind of walk me through your childhood, what you were like as a kid growing up, and what sports you played, that kind of thing. Let's just start there.
Sure. So Hudson County, North Bergen, New Jersey. Youngest of five kids. The two oldest are my sisters, and then two boys, and then myself. Basically, first grade in Garfield, and then just kind of went through that school system. Sports-wise, the very first sport I got into was soccer, but that didn't last very long. I had a neighbor who had got into the area from Bolivia. And so obviously soccer is a big deal there. And so we just played soccer all the time. And then around sixth grade, I got into the Boys and Girls Club and the rec center and started playing basketball. And it was great because the high school courts were about two blocks from my house, so I would literally spend entire summers there. So basketball was basically my first love. And that's all I did, man. Like, I literally just played a lot of basketball. So for about 4 or 5 years, that's what I did all summer. So, I mean, outside of that, I didn't really, you know, experiment with sports too much. I mean, I played football when I was in seventh grade, but I was like a 115-pound middle linebacker, and kids were running through me, dude. I was getting crushed.
Oh, man, I have a similar experience.
Yeah, so, like, I had no form. Like, I couldn't tackle, so kids were running through my chin. Literally, if I didn't have a chin, even with a chin guard, after that season, my entire chin was raw from just getting exploded through, dude.
Oh, no.
I was always in the right spot, but I was getting crushed, man. it's funny, like, you know, obviously I wasn't that good, but I do have some fond memories of football, and I did enjoy it, but then I transitioned. I mean, I just focused on basketball, and so when I got to high school, that's basically what I really focused on was basketball. And so I ran cross country to get into shape for it. And then through cross country, I did track my first year. So my freshman year in high school. And then track and volleyball, when it was bad weather outside, raining, whatnot, we would warm up inside. So we would see the volleyball guys. And then that's how I was kind of introduced to it. And then so the following year, my sophomore year in high school is when I stopped running. I just got burnt out from running so much. And that's where my volleyball story kind of started.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay, so then just backtracking a little bit there.
Sure.
With basketball, what was the – I mean, you said you fell in love with it. That was your first love. What was the primary allure? Like what kept you so –
my oldest brother, George, he's 10 years older than me. So he was kind of in college when I was in high school, or actually had just finished, but he was always big time in basketball and he played volleyball too. So he kind of introduced me to him and, kind of that older brother and trying to emulate his success. I just kind of got sucked into it and it was everything. It was my escape. I enjoyed it. And, you know, it was something to keep me out of trouble and to focus on. So it was great.
Gotcha. So I'm almost getting some sort of Trevor Crabb vibes almost. I think he had a similar story. He, like both the brothers, they love playing volleyball, but I know Trevor went down the basketball path first before he came back. So I'm getting a little bit of Trevor Crabb vibes.
I mean, those guys are studs. Yeah. I don't know their story, but hopefully I get that good at volleyball soon.
Definitely. I know what you mean. So what about, like, let's talk a little bit about academics and stuff. Were you a good student? What was your favorite subject? Like, what was that about?
So it's funny, when I was listening to Frazier's episode, he talked about being with the basketball guys. And so, I mean, I just smirked when I was hearing it because, I mean, honestly, like, when I say sports were the only thing that mattered, like, that's all that mattered. Like, I just, I only actually cared about sports. So academically, although, I mean, my parents and my siblings always wanted me, you know, they pushed me to do well in school. I just never had that inner drive for it. And it didn't really click for me till I got to college. When I was a sophomore in college, and that's when it hit me, like, all right, what are you going to do with your life? And I figured whatever I wanted to do, I would have to be pretty good at it. So I was like, you know what? I'm in school. Let me at least, you know, it's not that it was hard. It was really just a matter of separating enough time to actually do what needed to be done. And so that's all I did. I dedicated enough time. And I mean, the grades just followed. But as far as like it mattering, you know, it didn't matter as far as like, I just did enough to get by, basically.
Okay. So then when you came to college, you've realized it was more of, all right, let me apply myself.
Yeah, exactly.
And just like on the court, if I put in the work, I'll get the results.
Yeah. And then I got straight A's. But before that, I was like a BC guy. And I was just like, all right, that's enough. Like, I just want to get to practice. Like, I don't really – whatever. So.
Gotcha.
Yeah, man.
With basketball, were you involved, like, in travel sports, rec sports? I'm sure you were doing that whole circuit, right?
Yeah, but so there was, I mean, AAU wasn't, or like, for example, like club volleyball, like even though it existed back then, it wasn't as big. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't really have the opportunity. I only played like, you know, Garfield City stuff, you know what I mean? So the Boys okay. and Girls Club and the Rec Center, but that's all the kids within my same city. And then it was, once I got to freshman year, that's when I finally started playing kids from around the area.
Okay, I got you.
Yeah.
So then to kind of close out the early life segment, could you just give me maybe your fondest memory or your favorite story from growing up, whether it's in sports or just any facet of life growing up?
Fondest memory. That's tough. I mean, we'll keep it sports related. I mean, although I've had a ton of success, you know, not like an insane amount, but as far as like, you know, winning big matches and stuff like that. I when I look back to high school and the early years of my life, my senior year for basketball, we had a nice stretch where we won a couple state tournament games and just reminiscing on, you know, how it kind of livened up the community and, you know, just like playing in front of massive crowds, you know, hometown vibe. So that was a ton of fun, like that entire week of just like winning big games at home and just having everyone from around, you know, your city just coming to support you. Kids in the, you know, stands spray painting their name on their chest. It was it was dope. It was just a lot of fun. So, I mean, early childhood, that's a week I'll never forget. That was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think when Frazier mentioned, it's kind of like some of these memories that just stick with you for the rest of your life. And I'm sure that's probably, you know, having that experience for you, that's, you're going to take that to the grave probably, right?
Yeah, I mean, it was fun. It was fun. Hopefully we can get better memories, but that's definitely, you know, a good one to have.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I think the whole process with sports and everything is. You live for the competition, but ultimately what you take back is the memory. It's like the only thing that will ultimately stay with you. So
definitely
to that, we'll keep making memories.
Dope.
So then I guess we can hop into a little bit with volleyball now. So I know you play all types of volleyball. You play sand volleyball. You play indoor volleyball. You play grass volleyball. So you said you started playing volleyball in high school.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, when did you start playing beach? Because I think that's probably your primary focus at this point, right?
Yeah. So like I said, I started playing volleyball in general sophomore year in high school. That was all indoor stuff. And then when I got to Ramapo, that's where I met Shane and Dan Simkowski. And so Luca Taramina, he's another guy that played beach volleyball. And so I guess it was in preseason or maybe even during spring break, I think. But, you know, one of the breaks, we got all the guys together and we just went to one of the sand courts on campus. And that was the very first time. And so Shane and Dan Semp were just like running through everybody. And I'm like, this is pretty cool. Like, you know, I just realizing how much more responsibility and how much, you know, it's harder. You have to master every skill rather than just, you know, there's some plays where you don't pass or you don't do anything in indoor. But in outdoor, you're doing something. So then it kind of just clicked and then, you know, I did it, you know, sporadically, not too much, but then I think I was 19 years old, 20 years old when I started playing beach and I was like, you know what, I want to kind of pursue this and see how good I can get. And, and then I played my first Gav and Luca, the guy that I mentioned earlier, he was my first partner. And it's funny because, you know, when you start, you're basically kind of, you got to work your way through it. And the very first match I played was against Vaughn and Zahn. And we got waxed at Seaside. And I'm like, I think we played open. I think we did. Yeah.
Okay.
And we got waxed. I mean, it was so bad.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was like, all right, maybe we got to, you know, work our way back down, you know. So then I just played double A for a while, I think a season and a half or something like that. And the best I did was third. And it was frustrating because I was like, I'm so much more athletic than a lot of these guys and I should be playing better. And I'm losing to old guys that are just like not even jumping. And I was just so frustrated, man. But eventually, you know, you kind of understand the adjustments you have to make based on, you know, who you're playing. And then following summer, I was just like, all right, I don't care what happens. I'm just going to take my lumps and open. and then just kind of went from there. But I've been playing both. I mean, every kind of volleyball, grass, sand, indoor. I feel like I adjust with the seasons, but definitely my worst one is grass. Like I have times where I'm just like, I can't figure this out. And I don't know why. I don't get it, but it's the one that I struggle with the most.
So I think you played in Pottstown last year, right?
Yes.
Okay. And do you expect to play again this season to try to give another shot?
Oh, I'm going to play every year I can. Yeah. I love that tournament. Yeah, no, I'm far from throwing in the towel, man. It's too much fun, too much fun. But yeah, I mean, if there is a Pottstown, I expect to be there for sure.
For sure. And then with your career in indoor, I believe you play with Team Freedom, right?
Yeah.
What's that like?
It's great, man. I mean, great group of guys, a lot of ballers. So the core of guys have played with or against each other for, it seems like, a decade now. So there's a lot of mutual respect and, you know, there's a lot of chemistry. So, you know, it's just a ton of fun. And even off the court, you just really know each other. So it's not like you're really forcing anything. It's a really good time.
Gotcha. So one thing I wanted to circle back on was, I remember you mentioned early on in your high school sports days, you were at 115 pounds.
I think I was in seventh grade.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's a far cry from your build now. So I'm sure from that transformation, you developed a lot of physicality towards your game. So how did you make that happen? I think Frazier was telling me you're actually a gym rat. That's all you do. You lift.
I love lifting, man. Yeah, it's kind of one of my escapes. It's a routine. So that's another influence that my older brother had on me. He used to always take me to the gym, and, you know, he taught me lifts and, you know, kind of how to approach the gym. And then when I got into it, I just kind of dove into different, you know, different lifts and how to improve things I wanted to focus on. And eventually I got certified as a personal trainer, which didn't really take off, but I still kind of kept all of that knowledge and kind of applied it to the stuff I wanted to do. And so I kind of mixed in some powerlifting with plyos and a lot of calisthenics. So, I mean, I kind of have this a little bit of routine that I try to, you know, mix it up here and there. But yeah, man, I love the gym. It's a lot of fun.
Gotcha. So then if you had to give some advice, since we're quarantined right now and everyone's at home, what's some homework that we should be doing to get overall, you know, more athletic, more explosive, that kind of thing?
Oh, man. Explosiveness, I would say find your nearest hill and just do some hill sprints, man. I mean, not only will it build endurance, but it'll build explosive power and strength in your legs. So sprints are great. I jump rope all the time just to work on coordination, timing, and just endurance overall. And then you can do plyos anywhere, man. Like, you know, just lunge jumps, max jumps, you know, just if you look up on Google plyometrics to increase your vert, half of them, I mean, a ton of them don't require any equipment, you know? And then also, a lot of people don't notice or understand that your core is a huge part in your explosiveness. I mean, anything you do, from jumping to hitting, balance, coordination. So just find a good ab circuit and do it, you know, 4 or 5 times a week, and you'll see results, man.
Gotcha. One thing with working out, though, is I think it's easier to work out and push yourself when you have someone who's knowledgeable there with you or just someone else that's helping you do it. But how do you keep yourself accountable when you're by yourself and you have to push yourself? Otherwise, you're not going to make gains.
Oh, man. That's the toughest part right now is, I mean, so when I was up in Boston, my buddy, we used to live together, and yeah, he goes really hard. So we kind of push each other. When I have an off day, he's there to pick me up. When he's having an off day, I dig in and trying to pick him up. But when you're on your own, the way I try to stay motivated is I watch like videos through YouTube. Like, for example, I'll watch a match where I didn't play well, or I'll watch a baller squad, you know, like international player, whatever it may be. Just something that will kind of light a fire of like, okay, I either want to get there or I want to improve on this. in that sense, you know, guys like CT Fletcher is just like kind of curse you out and make you kind of just get pumped up.
I command you to grow.
Yeah, like, I mean, I don't care what you're feeling, dude. If you watch one of his videos, you're going to kind of get motivated to do anything.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Okay. That's a neat little trick, I think. Yeah. Maybe I'll have to do that before I hit some of my at-home lift sessions.
Yeah, man.
Cool. I guess with the hill sprints, a recommended set of reps or like what's that scheme like?
Yeah, so, I mean, you don't want to do too many of them. I would say keep between 5 and 7. But I would do 2 back-to-back. So, for example, sprint up the hill, walk back, sprint up the hill, walk back, and then probably take a 5-minute break and then do it again. But it's all relative, you know, it depends on what baseline you're working with.
Yeah, gotcha. And then in conjunction with that, you can do all the exercise you want, but if your diet is not clean, then you will not make any progress. So what's your advice with diet?
Oh, diet, dude. So, I mean, I have a pretty solid routine when it comes to food. I mean, I eat oatmeal probably 6 times a week for breakfast. Just to get in a good routine, make sure I'm getting in that first meal. Mm-hmm. I think a big thing for volleyball guys, or even just females too, you know, you just, if you're out there playing all day, you just lose so much weight. So it's tough to kind of maintain a build or strength. It just feels like it's just falling off of you. So getting good calories into you is a big part of, you know, kind of, you know, having good energy levels and also strength overall. So, I mean, oatmeal, I make juice. So basically I'll get like beets, ginger, ginger root, lemon, carrots and apples. And then I'll juice that up. So I just have that in the fridge. So I'll drink that once a day. And then I blend up celery, parsley and cucumber. And that's kind of like a morning drink for me. So, I mean, I'm not really big on vegetables. So the way that I kind of deal with that is I just make juices that I just crush quickly so that I know that I'm still getting what I need. But, you know, I don't really prioritize them in big meals. So basically I hack myself to just crush a juice 2 to 3 times a day. And that way I'm still getting, you know, vegetables and stuff like that and fiber into me. But I mean, it's important to, you know, I mean, it's tough because you have to deal with your palate or whatever your preferences are, but you just have to, on the other hand, know what your body needs if you're going to try to compete at a high level. So it's a balance there, and then you find what works for you.
That makes sense. No, I think that's a perfect way to describe it, because I think often on the beach, if you don't properly feel yourself, then you'll feel the effects right away, whether it's cramping, whether it's losing your explosiveness.
Dude,
the beach and the sand won't lie.
Dude, I cannot tell you. So remember when we were talking earlier about my first open season on the beach? I mean, obviously your first open season, your number one goal is to just clear your pool, right? And so for so many tournaments, I was just getting crushed in pool play, not making it out. And then finally, once I started breaking that pool kind of level, I then had this cramping problem where now I made playoffs, but immediately that first playoff match, I was always, I'm talking about aggressive cramps, man. Like you can't even play through them. And I was so frustrated. I didn't understand what was going on. But once I started to address my diet and mobility issues, then it kind of fixed, you know, then I was able to play. And, you know, that wasn't a factor, but it was horrible. But yeah, it's a big deal, man.
Definitely. So I think that's a great segue into my next question. So once you started breaking pool and, you know, you started experiencing that bit of success, what was your mindset like and what helped you get to that next level?
I would definitely have to say the biggest factor is the people around you. So basically I was fortunate enough to train with guys like, you know, Frazier, Vaughn, back in the day, Eric Zahn was around a bunch. AJ's been around, and just this great group of guys where you kind of get connected and you train often. And basically by playing better competition, you adapt, you grow, and you make the changes you need in order to be successful. So it just happens naturally that way. Mm-hmm. But you need to have a baseline in order to, like, when what he mentioned in his episode was you need to bring something to the table. So I was always pretty athletic, and I always have a lot of energy when I play, but I always lack ball control. And so that was where they kind of picked me up, running drills and noticing their footwork or the way they would, you know, adjust after a pass. And so you pick up on these little things and you just try to be a sponge and you ask questions and you look up drills for things you need to work on. And then you just go from there. And basically every summer you try to pick one or two skills that you really want to improve. And then eventually, you know, it kind of all comes together and you improve. It's a little, it's a process. You're sculpting your game in a sense. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. So then would you say like that's around the time, if you can give me your, like that's around the time where you were inducted into East Coast Mafia?
That was, I think, 2 years ago. 2 years ago, okay. I got the call. That was funny because so like all my guys are in there. And I mean, obviously I heard about it. Great group of guys. And I mean, I didn't expect to get the call. But it was great. It was a lot of fun. I mean, being involved in the talks and stuff like that. It's a great group of guys. Good networking. And I mean, volleyball is, in a sense, all networking too, you know? You can be really good, but if nobody wants to play with you, that's good. I mean, you can only go so far. So it's really great to have a network of group of guys where you can kind of, you know, bounce off ideas or, hey, I got a big match coming up. Does anybody know how this guy plays? I don't know him at all. So it's great to kind of have that information and that group of guys that kind of keeps you accountable. So it's great.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so definitely you're saying that East Coast Mafia played a big role in your development as a player and as a person.
Definitely. I mean, as far as the game, you know, you tend to get this bigger picture, you know, having guys all over the country and then getting their input on, you know, for example, a guy like Mark Burek, you know, he's, you know, growing the game out there in Cali and doing big things. And that's literally his entire life. So, you know, his input, I mean, he's really vested in the game. So, I mean, it's great to have that kind of resource. Hudson Bates, you know, a guy who had a ton of success at a high level and just, you know, really cool guys at the same time. You know what I mean? You're not dealing with guys who won't talk to you or something. You know, it's a good group of guys.
So would you say there's anyone in particular within that group that, you know, maybe you relied more on for developing your physical game and then someone else you could talk to for developing your mental game?
I mean, so like I said, I joined it recently, but overall I would say, I mean, if anything, my main guy would be Shane. You know, he's once again, going back to that, you know, practice on the beach on Rampo's campus, I would have never got into the game or even, you know, I mean, I had heard of it, but never really considered it for myself till that day. And then obviously once I started playing, he was just doing really well already. Him and Fraser were winning everything when I started playing. So, he was always a great resource and we've had a great friendship, for a long time. But I mean, we kind of go hard at each other at practice and we're pretty similar in that fashion where we talk a lot of trash to each other and we know how to kind of hit each other's buttons and you know, it's all in good fun because I mean, we get motivated by that stuff. So it's pretty cool to be able to go hard at someone and want to beat them down in a match, but then afterwards you just kind of, you know, you respect and you have some fun with it.
Mm-hmm. So I think that brings up two very like vivid points in my head. So I definitely want to talk about motivation with you as well as the role of talking smack. So funny enough, I have a very fond memory from, do you remember when you played the Indian tournament?
Yes, I do. Where was that again? That was in Central Jersey somewhere?
Yeah, Central Jersey at All Season Sportsplex or something.
Yeah, but I do remember that.
The reason why I remember that so vividly is because we had an individual, Joseph Torres, on our team. Yes. And we were playing your team, and you two were going at it, and you just kept on blocking him, and you just kept on getting his head and talking smack. And there was one point where I think you definitely cursed through the net or something, and then everyone's like, yo, get this man a yellow card, get this man a red card.
I mean, nothing happened.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, I mean, Joseph and I, man, so we go back to SOS days, and I played with him a bunch when we were on Mount Mohana, and even before that, he was just always around. So, I mean, once again, like, you're just kind of trying to get a competitive edge. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times it's not even to try to get into the opponent's head. It's to get me going. You know what I mean? So yeah, that there, I mean, if Joseph gets on a roll, he's pretty good. You know what I mean? So I just tried to beat him to the punch of getting in my zone before he got into his. But yeah, I mean, I go pretty hard sometimes. And I mean, I've had plenty of situations where I've crossed the line, and you know, you live, you learn, and you keep it moving, you know?
No, that's definitely true. That's definitely true. I also know that within East Coast Mafia, there's all this rivalry and all these great stories. And Frazier mentioned on the last episode that you're the one who coined the term face nutter for his epic dance move. So what's all that about?
Oh, man. So we played a tournament in Point. And then afterwards, I think he had a beach house. We had a beach house. And so we all got ready and we went out to Headliners in Belmar, I think it is, right? And so we go, and so this is a, you know, loud music, you know, that environment for dancing. So we're all having a good time on the dance floor. And, you know, obviously a couple drinks, whatnot. And Frazier just has this thing where, I mean, he just commands attention when he's dancing. Not only is he, like, you know, a really tall, athletic, you know, handsome guy, but, like, he just, the way he dances, it's just like a lot of energy, a lot of moves, and people just watch, you know? So now, naturally, a circle forms all of the time. Like, you go out with Frazier, there's a 99% chance that there will be a circle and he will be dancing in it. And so through that process, there's going to be another guy in that place who also thinks that they can dance.
Yep.
It's, and like, that's great.
It's almost like a fight to the death of
like stomp the yard. This guy thinks he can dance. I've been dancing. I'm the best guy in my crew. I'm gonna challenge this guy. So boom, Frazier comes out, does his thing. Then the guy, and so like usually it's like two or three rounds. But so this night, same thing, two or three rounds. It's dark, strobe lights. It's crazy, and his finale, so the very first time he pulled this move out, once again, we're at Headliners, it's packed. So this guy has his whole crew, it's us and our crew, and so they're in the middle of this dance. And mind you, so it's back in the day especially, Frazier and Danny Lee always danced together. I don't remember if Danny Lee was out this night, but I remember him and Frazier always dancing together. So third round or so, this guy finishes. And so once again, like, when the other guy's dancing, he's just kind of like standing in the circle. And so naturally the other guy does the same thing. So Frazier, ridiculously athletic, he does this thing where he gets in the guy's face. He goes up and down, does like this stomp the yard deal. And then he just max jumps, grabs the back of this guy's head and literally humps his face one time really hard.
Oh my God.
Oh my gosh, bro. I had never seen this before, and everybody in the crowd is just like, oh. Now, the guy, obviously, so now once again, you're a guy, and you just got humped in the face in front of everyone in this nightclub. So the very first reaction is obvious, shock, right? Just like, oh my God, that just happened. What do I do now? So immediately, obviously, the next step is to fight. So so all of a sudden, his boys step up, our boys step up, and luckily, I don't know, I think some girls got in between and kind of settled it down. But long story short, these guys have to go home knowing that they got humped in public. And Frazier has done that about five times in front of me. And every single time we've almost fought. But it's epic. I mean, sometimes we go into it and I'm like, all right, you got a face nut of this guy.
You guys fix it like a selective crowd, someone you don't like.
Like these people want to see it, you know?
Give and, the people what they want.
Yeah, dude. So he's, I don't know where in his thought process that even came up, but he does it. It's hysterical. And it definitely – is a cherry on top of his victory.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
So it's serious, man. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, no, I feel honestly pretty blessed to have witnessed it last year in AC at Big Shots.
Oh, so, my gosh, dude. Man. I mean, was it the same steps of shock and should I hit him or how do I walk away? I don't know what to do right now.
Exactly. I mean, it was with Cameron, so Frazier was saying that, like, they're friends, so.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. The part. Oh, my God. If it happened to me, it would be bad.
That's why I'm just not stepping in the ring. I'll stick to my own little.
I mean, I don't have. I enjoy dancing, but I don't get into dance circles. That's not my thing.
Yeah, same. Not for me.
But I mean, Frazier's that guy in our crew. So I mean, I'll always, you know, give him the nod.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree. And because of that, we'll have memories to look forward to in the past, and to continually make as well at every one of these big parties.
Oh yeah, for sure.
All right, awesome. With that, I think we can wrap up the East Coast Mafia chapter. And I wanted to circle back a little bit about motivation. How exactly did you figure out that this kind of, you know, loud and talking smack and like internal fire was your style of motivation? Because that doesn't apply for everyone. And with different partners you play, not everyone's going to respond the same way. So how do you adjust your style of motivation internally as well as externally when you play?
Yeah, so I mean, I guess the way I approach it, and it's not the same with everyone, it's even with, you know, it depends on your partner and how they react to, you know, the way you play and also your opponent. Because there's guys that you play and you're going to say, all right, I'm not going to trash talk this guy. I'm just going to keep my energy inward. You know what I mean? I'm going to keep my energy on my side of the net. And then there's some guys where you know that they're susceptible to cracking under that constant pressure. So I mean, it's definitely based off of, you know, who you're playing with and who you're playing against. Mm-hmm. And I mean, as I've kind of matured, I've learned when to turn it on, when to kind of play certain ways and try to use that to my advantage. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say so early on. I might play like that all the time. But now I try to pick my battles, and it's an energy thing, too. So, I mean, first game of the day, you're not going to come out roaring, because then by the finals, you're not going to have any energy, right? So you need to know when you're going to bring it out, and, you know, when you're going to use it, who you're going to use it against, and when you need it, you know, XYZ. So you got to break it down too. But I definitely enjoy that style. You'll notice it. I mean, if you watch any of the Team Freedom stuff, the guys just kind of, and volleyball is a very momentum based sport. I mean, you can say that all sports are, but I mean, when you're playing, you just kind of get into the zone. And when it feels like when good things are happening, they just have no choice. Like, it just continues to go well. Mm-hmm. And so I try to kind of control the ebbs and flows of the game based off of that energy and just trying to kind of drown the opponent when it's the right move, you know?
I gotcha. Yep. That makes sense to me. So I guess one thing I wanted to learn a little bit more about too was, you know, what your goals were for the upcoming season. I think it's going to be, hopefully we pick up very soon, because I know everyone's dying to get back at it. But what are you specifically looking to achieve this upcoming season?
Man, I mean, the goals are always the same. I want to win Pottstown. I want to qualify multiple times, and those are big goals. I don't shy away from that. But I was looking forward to, I mean, so last season was a tough season for me with the move to Boston and, obviously trying to find a job up in that area. So it was a difficult season for me playing wise. And I was really looking forward to, and I still am looking forward to, kind of getting back on track and leveling up this year. But the goals are always the same, man. I want to qualify multiple times, win a Pottstown, win a Woolpack a boat ride, play big tournaments, play good teams and beat those teams. You know, it's I'm at the point now where, you know, just playing well isn't enough. I looking for, getting into a quali and having continued success. You know what I mean?
Success. I think I love the word success, because everyone measures it differently. But for you, how do you exactly measure success? What are some of your yardsticks, and how has that changed throughout your career?
So when you look at the rankings, I guess you could call it, within beach volleyball, right? You know, you can always put yourself at a certain spot, right? Based off of local players, your region, the Northeast, the whole East Coast, you know, and then you can talk about the country, right? So you can kind of put yourself in a certain spot. And I guess for me, success is continually growing within that ranking system. And I'm not saying it like, you know, AVP America points. Like, that's not what does it for me. I understand that the results will get me the points I want. You know, it's I'm not focused on those points. But I'm just saying, like, there's guys that I know that are a little better than me, and I want to beat those guys. And then there's guys that are a little, you know, I wouldn't say worse, but they're not as good, or I wouldn't say consider them to be on my level. And so I know that they're fighting to knock me off while I'm fighting to knock the guy above me off. So it's just that fight of, like, you know, improving and getting the results and trying to knock a guy off while still kind of keeping your level as far as the guys that you know you should be beating.
Mm-hmm. That's a great point. And I think that kind of segues into what I was wondering next. And I know I asked Frazier this, but did you ever feel like you were at a disadvantage being from the East Coast and from Jersey, I guess, when you're going into qualifiers or you're going into these big tournaments?
No, man. I mean, so there's really good players on the East Coast. I mean, if you look at Florida, there's a bunch of really good players there. Even all the way up, I mean, you go through each state, I'm sure you can find one or two guys that are really good, you know, players. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that we're at a huge disadvantage. I mean, is the bulk of the talent on the West Coast? Yes. I mean, the weather is more conducive for the sport, right? All of that stuff. But I think now that tide is kind of leveling out just because of the indoor facilities. Mm-hmm. I mean, I literally moved up to Boston now that Highline just opened, but that's massive. Like, that's massive for the game. Yeah. The impact that's going to have on the next generation is huge. Think of, like, 12-year-olds that play for the next 10 years, but, you know, understand the beach game, know, you know, strategy, have ball control, you know, and then they, you know, obviously you incorporate the win and stuff like that in summer, but they're still drilling year round for the sport. And that's going to translate, you know, positively regardless. So, I mean, I think that at this point, that tide is changing where you can be successful anywhere. I mean, granted, you need to have good competition around you, but you can still travel. You know, I mean, if you've got a job that provides you the ability to travel and go to these tournaments in Ohio, Cali, Florida, and all these different places, you can get the competition you need while still living on any East Coast state. So, yeah, although it's obvious that the bulk of the talent pool is in Cali and on the West Coast, I would say that that's changing.
Yeah, that makes sense. So what I'm kind of getting at is the opportunity definitely exists, but it's up to you to go and seize it.
Definitely. You can find any court and drill and work. I mean, I think I remember seeing, so the Bohmgrens, they're from, you know, the Midwest, and I saw a video of them, like, peppering in the snow and, like, doing two-man drills, and they did really well. I know the lefty, that played with Troy Field last season.
Yeah, that's Tim, yep.
He's filthy. He's really filthy, and I think he might have moved to Cali, but before, you know, I think two seasons prior to that, he was still in the Midwest somewhere. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
I mean, he was obviously still really good 2 years before that. Maybe he hit another level, but as far as, you know, overall competition and skill, I would say that he's, you know, still very, very good. So based off of where you are, your intrinsic motivation and your determination is definitely going to be a bigger factor than am I from the East Coast or the West Coast? Because there's plenty of guys from the West Coast that aren't making qualifiers. So that's not the only key.
Yep. No, I 100% agree with that. And I think that kind of gives me a glimpse into your mindset. And so, like, that makes me, all right. So what I want to ask you next is when I was reaching out to you earlier, when I was following your Instagram, I saw a quote on your Instagram bio, and it said, "The unexamined life is not worth living" by Socrates. Yeah. What does that mean to you?
So basically, it's just about kind of being introspective and looking inside and kind of just trying to grow and not just go through life and be at the whim of everything around you. You know, try to find what you can control and do your best with that. And that's basically it. I mean, I love Stoic philosophy. It's all about that, you know, finding what you can control, not giving it things outside of you power on you, you know, things like that, controlling your emotions, keeping a clear and logical approach to things so that you can make the best decisions. I meditations from Marcus Aurelius, stuff like that. It's just, I found it as a great tool for life in general.
Okay.
So I really enjoy it.
It's, you're extracting these tidbits from these great ancient thinkers, and it's on your tool belt for handling the stresses of life.
Yeah, I love it, dude.
So I know that one was from Socrates. Any other particular philosophers that are your favorite? And that are worth investigating and for people to look into more?
I mean, I've read the book, The Daily Stoic from Ryan Holiday. Mm-hmm. That's from all different kind of philosophers. He has another book called The Obstacle is the Way. I mean, I wouldn't focus on one. You know, obviously, Socrates is a big guy. You know, once again, I mentioned Marcus Aurelius' Meditations. So, I mean, just there, you have a ton of stuff to dive into. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot within that. And it's just impressive how Marcus Aurelius was, most powerful man in his day. And, you know, he had these thoughts on how he should rule best. And it's just like, I mean, I don't have, you know, a quarter of that responsibility. So I just try to take what he learned and thought was useful and try to, incorporate it.
Gotcha. One more thing with that then is I know a lot of Stoic philosophy is also based upon the external journey and internal journey. So like, and its role in life. So for you particularly, what has been the bigger challenge for you to overcome or to, you know, struggle at, become better at?
All right. So can you explain that to me? You kind of broke up a little bit. I'm sorry.
So yeah, no problem. So the external journey versus the internal journey in the sphere of volleyball, what has been a bigger challenge for you to become better at? External being, you know, the physical success of playing better at volleyball, getting your skills up, versus the internal journey where, you know, you're letting go of the ego. Not trying to equate results with your improvement, that kind of thing.
That's a great question. So 100% the internal journey. When I was thinking about this podcast and whatnot, I was thinking back to when I first started playing. And so the way it works is that progression through partners, and you're always trying to do better, be better, and get better partners to ultimately get better finishes, right? Mm-hmm. And so through that process, I was so focused all of the time on the guy next to me, right? What he's not doing right, what he can do to help me. And through all of that, like thinking back, I'm like, wow, I was a terrible partner. Like I had entire seasons where, I mean, my girlfriend would tell me, people would be like, man, look, Josh is mad again. And I'm just like, they don't understand. Mm-hmm. Like I'm just competitive. Like they don't get it. And eventually, you know, through this search for kind of finding control and like not understanding why I wasn't doing as well as I wanted to or thought I should have been doing, I realized that, I needed to turn that inward, instead of yelling at my partner about things that I thought they should be doing well. I tried to just like think, okay, he hit the ball out. Did I not set him well? Could I get him, is the tempo off? Did I not put him in a good spot? Like just thinking of things. Okay, so my partner's getting served every time. Am I going to be mad because he's not siding out? Or am I going to go back and serve a couple aces and try to get some pressure off of him so he can kind of get into his zone and we can do better together, right? So, like, it was just this change of mentality which really allowed me to be a better partner, which in turn created a lot more success. And that really propelled me to do much better within the ranks than, actual playing and stuff, which is obviously important. But through that, if you don't have the right mentality, you're just going to be your own worst enemy. You're just always going to be angry, and you're not going to know why, and you're not going to enjoy the game, and you're not going to make any relationships, which is really what it's all about, you know? And people aren't going to want to, you know, watch your matches or even play with you or things like that. Right. So in general, that internal struggle of understanding what I could do to improve my attitude, your inner talk, right? That inner monologue that everyone has, right? Like, you make a mistake. Are you freaking out in your head, or are you just breathing and saying, all right, next ball, I'm going to pass this one, or next time I'm going to get that dig because I know that, you know, my footwork was off, and you can kind of logically process why it happened rather than just being mad that you didn't do what you thought you should have done.
That deeply resonates with me.
Yeah, that's to me that, I mean, as you improve and you're grinding through the levels, as we call them, you know, as we've been kind of naming it, it's it's like that, you know, you just gotta, you know, I think that the biggest battle is the inside one, the internal one, for sure.
Yep. No, I think that's a great insight. And that really does resonate with me, because I think something I've encountered on that journey is, as you mentioned, like sometimes you'll be like, all right, is it my partner? Am I not setting him right? And you get that feeling, that anguish, or that, you know, that despair. But it's okay for you to understand that both those things can simultaneously exist, that you know that it's not you, but at the same time, you can feel that way and acknowledge it, but also put it on the back seat because it's just a feeling.
Yeah, exactly. And then even if it is an external thing where you're just not passing well, or whatever the case, or you're not blocking enough, or whatever it is, you can't approach that issue with a clear mind, with, you know, a plan to improve it, if you're just emotionally out of whack internally. You know what I'm saying? So that's definitely, I would say, the bigger part of it.
Do you have any techniques or anything like that where you're on the court or just in life, when you start to experience that or you feel it, that you kind of turn to help you with that?
Yeah, definitely. So 100%, I try to focus on relaxing my, or like taking deep breaths and controlling my breathing. And then through those deep breaths, I try to, even if I'm frustrated and angry, I try to create this positive monologue, like within myself, like, we're all right. What's wrong? How do we fix it? What do we need to change in order to kind of turn the tide here? And so like the, you know, 15 seconds or 10 seconds or so in between plays, that's definitely where I try to go. It's just like, try to breathe, think, okay, what's next? Okay, it's fine. They just made a play. Now you got to pass the ball. It is what it is. Boom. And then kind of just try to kind of ground yourself on what needs to be accomplished next, rather than just harping on the mistake that happened.
Awesome. I think that's really powerful and insightful stuff. I think anyone who listens to this, that's something they can definitely take away, and it's directly translatable. So thanks for sharing that. And I know that we're getting closer to the end of the segment, so
sure.
I want to be respectful of your time. And with the last couple minutes, you probably heard it from Chris's segment, but I like to finish off with a choice of yours. So if you would like to proceed with the rapid fire challenge, or since you are a teacher, would you like to participate in the Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader segment?
Oh, no, dude. I'm doing rapid fire. Come on, rapid fire. Yeah, if you start hitting me with math questions, it's going to get ugly, man.
All right, that's fair. All right, we can go with rapid fire then. So, all right. Ready, set, go. What song is stuck in your head right now?
Oh, man. So, Hey Soul Sister, but I have to give you some context on that. My fiance's been listening to The Voice like crazy, and this kid Levi crushes his rendition of Hey Soul Sister, and it's been in my head all day, bro. So that's the song, Hey Soul Sister.
Gotcha. Favorite drink?
Water.
Okay. Are you a morning person or are you a night owl?
Morning person.
Okay. Do pineapples belong on pizza?
Yes, they do. Hawaiian pizza is great. You gotta have ham on it though. Pineapple and ham.
I'm not opposed to that, but the pineapples do belong on pizza. That is the answer.
Yes.
Favorite vacation destination?
Oh, Spain. So much to do, so much to learn. It's beautiful.
Where in Spain?
Everywhere. But, I mean, you can go. I mean, I've been to Barcelona, Toledo, Madrid, Sevilla. I mean, there's just the different regions give you a different flavor. It's amazing, man. You can go anywhere and have an amazing time.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I went to Barcelona last year after I graduated. So
you know what it is.
Yeah, see. And favorite comedian?
Favorite comedian. That's a tough one, dude. That's a really tough one. I'm going to go with Dave Chappelle.
Dude, I agree with you. I totally agree. Yes. I don't know if you've seen his most recent special where he accepted the Mark Twain Prize for like the most comedic, but you should watch that. All right,
I'll check it out. Is it on Netflix?
Yeah, Netflix.
All right, I'll check it out.
All right, bet. And then I guess my last question, high line, cutty, or a bounce on the 10-foot line?
Oh, cutty, man. I mean, you hit somebody with a cutty and you hit them with a little trash talk, that's going to get somebody fired up. I love that's the one right there.
What's your go-to little quip? What do you say to someone after you hit them with a cutty?
You never had a chance. You never had a chance.
Oh, man, that's a dagger.
That one hurts. If you cut it on somebody, they fall to the knee because they didn't react, and then you're like, "Oh, you never had a chance. You thought you had a chance?
Oh,
that's
man.
Sad. I'm so sorry."
Awesome. I really appreciate it. That's hilarious, dude. Thank you.
Yeah, man. I appreciate you having me on, man. This is great.
No, I just want to capture the stories of what we got going on here, and I appreciate you contributing to it. So
yeah, I appreciate that. I appreciate your time. You're doing great stuff, man. Thank you.
No problem, Josue. Have a great night, all right? Take care.
You too, my man.